Hello and welcome to the 16th video of my L4D2 mapping tutorial series. Today we'll be going over the mission file. The mission file is a text file that allows your map or maps to work within the game's menu systems. They're required for all types of maps, campaign or survival. In the description is a link to the Valve Developer Community Wiki page going over mission files. It includes a template mission file that has pretty much everything we need, so let's select everything in here and copy it. Navigate to your L4D2 game files. You should know how to do that by now if you've reached the point of making a mission file. In the L4D2 game folder, open up the folder called Missions. If it's not there, create it. Now, create a new text file and give it a unique name. Make sure it's really unique, because if it conflicts with any other mods, then your campaign won't work. Now, open it up and paste what we copied from the wiki into here. The mission file isn't anything complicated, it's just a series of options we can choose or add to, and I'll be going over all of them. For the first line, name, just use the same name you gave the mission file. The version number is a whole integer used in matchmaking to determine if the version of the add-on on one's computer is out of date. Whenever you update the map, increase the version number by one whole number. First version is 1, second version is 2, etc. Next, the display title. This is what the map will be named in the game's UI. Give it the proper name you want. Description is a short catchphrase for the map that will show up underneath the map when selecting it. It shouldn't be long. Author is obvious, it's you. The website line is the URL that hosts the download for the map. If you're uploading to the workshop, the game will automatically direct players to the workshop, so this is a little redundant. However, if you're uploading on something like Game Banana or Game Maps, I highly recommend putting the links to one of those downloads in here. We'll skip the outro image line for now and get back to it. Melee weapon defines what melee weapons can spawn in your map. The template mission file includes every melee in the game. Just erase an entry if you don't want it to spawn. Erase the last entry in the list called my_custom_melee. Survivor set defines what set of survivors the map should use. One is for the L4D1 crew, two is for the L4D2 crew. These next five options are explained succinctly in the commented text, and thus I won't be going over them because their purposes are extremely niche. This next group of options are related to the loading screen image. I'll be skipping the first two options and start with full screen. Just leave it to 1. L4D2 names, set it to 1 if you're using L4D2 survivors, otherwise set it to 0. Character order sets the order of the names in the bottom left of the loading screen. Change up the order if you wish. I recommend not because it's already in alphabetical order. Commented out is the character order for the L4D1 survivors. If you want the L4D1 crew in your map, remove the 2 forward slashes in front of the L4D1 character order and add 2 forward slashes in front of the L4D2 character order. Now we define the modes the maps included in the add-on can be played on. Included in the template is a setup for the campaign mode already, labeled co-op. Underneath the mode co-op is where you define all the maps that can be played on that mode. There's already lines written for one map. On the map line, change mymap1 to the map file name of the first level of the campaign. Next, set the display name to whatever you want to show as the name of the map in-game. Valve uses the convention number, indicating the position of the map in order, colon, and the name of the map. Probably best to use that naming convention to be consistent, but it doesn't really matter. The image line is the image that accompanies the specific map when selecting it in the menus. I also won't be going over it right now. I'll be going over all the images at the end of this video. In the template file are commented outlines for a second map. Remove the forward slashes to uncomment it, and again change the properties like before. Add more maps if you need. Make sure you're adding the curly brackets, indenting, and incrementing the map number one by one, or else the mission file will break. Next, we should add a second game mode that these maps can be played on, Versus. Versus is pretty much just campaign mode, but the infected team are controlled by players, so it doesn't need any extra logic or entities to get working, unlike survival. Select all the co-op mode lines and copy, then make 2 new lines after the closed curly bracket meant for closing the co-op mode, and paste. Replace co-op with Versus. Add VS in parentheses at the end of every display name property for each map. For each map after image, type in quotes, versus completion score, then indent, and in quotes type in a number. This is the maximum amount of points that could be earned for the map in versus. Valve maps mostly range from 500 to 800, depending on the map's length and difficulty. Remember when I said versus doesn't need any extra logic or entities to get it to work? Well, I actually lied. Versus mode actually needs one special entity in the finale map to ensure it works properly. Open the finale map in Hammer. Next, create an entity called info_gamemode. This entity has special outputs to fire whenever the map is loaded in a certain game mode. Open the outputs tab and create a new output on versus. Target the env underscore outro underscore stats entity, which in my case is just named outro, via the input kill. This output will kill the env outro stats entity, the entity that displays the end credits, whenever the map is loaded in the versus game mode. Compile the map. The map now works with the versus game mode. The wiki page we got the template script from has more options for versus if you scroll down, but they aren't necessary. I haven't covered the necessary entities and logic needed to make our campaign maps work with survival mode yet, so I won't be adding the survival mode into the mission file, but if you were to, you would simply add a new mode set for survival. If you were making a survival exclusive map, then you'd simply only have one mode for survival. We're done tinkering with the modes. Make sure there are no loose curly brackets anywhere or else they'll break the mission file. Let's go back and make all the loading screen and menu images for the maps, starting with the loading screen, or poster. There are two versions of the loading screen. One meant for widescreen monitors with a 16:9 aspect ratio, and one meant for monitors with a 4:3 aspect ratio. Here in my image editing software, I have a texture already made for widescreen. It has a resolution of 1920x1080, which is the most common 16:9 resolution. Now make a version meant for a 4:3 aspect ratio. An easy way to do this is to just select everything that's important in a box with a 4:3 ratio and crop out everything inside of it. Its resolution is now 1398x1049, but both 1920x1080 and 1398x1049 are not valid resolutions for VTF, as explained in my previous video where I go over making custom assets. We'll resize the images to make them valid. I'll resize the widescreen image to 2048x1024, because that's the closest power of two numbers for the width and height. The image will be a little stretched as a result, but it will unstretch back into 1920x1080 when it's used in game, so it'll be virtually unnoticeable. Next, I'll resize the 4:3 image to 1024x1024. Always start off by making the loading screens at the proper aspect ratio and squish it into the nearest power of two number on each dimension. I'll now save both images as a VTF with VTF edit. With both our images now turned into VTFs in hand, navigate to our game files. In video 15 of this series, I showed how to make a custom assets game folder, which is where we store all of our custom assets. Refer to that video if you don't have one, or follow along in the main Left 4 Dead 2 game folder. Open the materials folder and make a new folder called VGUI. Place both of the VTFs for the loading screen images into here. They must be placed into this folder. Now we need to make VMT files for each. Make a new text document and change the file extension from .txt to .vmt and open it up in Notepad. On the first line, write in quotes, unlit generic. Make a new line and type an open curly bracket, followed by a new line. Indent and type in quotes, $ base texture, followed by the file path to the texture in quotes, which in our case is just VGUI. Make a new line and type $ vertex color space 1, like so. Another line, type $ vertex alpha space 1. Another line, type in $no underscore Fulbright 1. Another line, type in $ translucent 1. Last one, type in $ ignore z 1. Close the texture off with a closed curly bracket. Next, copy and paste the VMT file, name it the same as the second loading screen texture, open it up, and change the base texture line accordingly. In the mission file, locate the poster image options and change them both to their respective VMT names. Now, let's make the outro image that appears at the end credits of the finale. Obviously, this isn't necessary if your maps aren't meant for campaign mode, but if they are, you have to make one of these. The outro image is simple, it's just the logo of the map on a black background. Here I have the image meant for the outro, with the resolution set to 1024x256. I'll save the image as a VTF and place it into the VGUI folder from before. Again, we can copy a VMT in here and change up the base texture property within it. In the mission file, locate the outro image option and change it to the name of the VMT we just made. Be sure to keep the VGUI and forward slash at the front though. Finally, we'll make all the images for each individual map. These simple in-game screenshots are displayed when choosing a map out of the campaign to play. Load up all of your maps and find a pretty spot to take a picture. You can take good screenshots by using a few console commands. First is director underscore stop, which turns off the director and prevents it from spawning zombies. Second is mb underscore delete underscore all, which deletes all bots from the game. Third is noclip, which lets you fly around. Fourth is cl underscore draw HUD 0, which turns off the HUD. Fifth is r underscore draw view model 0, which turns off the weapon view models. Once you've taken a screenshot for each map, open them up in an image editor, resize and crop them to fit in a resolution of 256x128, and save them as VTFs. With all of them saved, go to the VGUI folder and make a new folder within it called maps. Drop all the VTFs in there. And again, copy a VMT from one of the previous images we made and change the base texture line to reflect the VTF's new location and name. When that's done, open the mission file one last time. Under the mode section, change the image option to the VMT for each respective map. Be sure to keep the maps and forward slash at the front. Do this for all game modes you have. After all that, the mission file is done. Open Left 4 Dead 2. You should now see that you can select your map from the menus. It has the pretty images we made, along with a name and tagline. Beating the finale shows the outro image. This concludes the 16th video in my Left 4 Dead 2 mapping tutorial series. In the next video, we'll finally publish the map to the workshop for the whole world to see. Thank you for watching.